continuing the lesson. The angel of the Lord revealed Samson's special assignment. He shall begin to deliver Israel out of the hand of the Philistines. Judges 13:5. Tracing Samson's history, it is disappointing to see the strong, virile servant of Yahweh deflected from the pathway of righteousness by foreign women. And these women will, I mean, that's the spirit. These women will fuck you up, and it's true, for real. I mean, it's just amazing, you know, and when I'm reading this story, it got me thinking about my own, you know, cross the bear and whatnot. But, you know, many of the men have fallen out of this, you know, truth, or let a female be, you know, the barrier. And with that, I'm going to get a precept and with the Proverbs. Because this is, I mean, you know, this is Solomon, even though he went off. But it's the truth, you know. So we'll read this at the beginning. Proverbs 31, verse 1. The words of King Lemuel, the prophecy that his mother told him. Verse 2. What my son, Spakia, and what the son of my womb, and what the son of my vows. Verse 3. Give not thy strength unto the women, nor thy ways to that which destroyeth kings. So, you know what I'm saying? Like, at the end of the day, you're supposed to put your energy and your strength into this truth. You know, I'm not going to go into my own testimony, but, you know, that's just, you know, that's you being tested, you know what I mean? Like, at the end of the day. And I've seen a few brothers literally fall out this truth over women, you know what I'm saying? Me myself, you know, I, you know, got a demon, a real life demon dealing with me, you know. And like I say, I often listen to some of the arguments and I ask them, you know, they say the demons jump on her, you know, they ease or whatever. I don't even call mine a Eve, you know what I mean? But, you know, it ain't a spirit jumping on her, that bitch the devil. You know what I'm saying? Like, the devil's concubine. But, you know, she is the demon, because, you know what I mean? Like, she be really trying to stop me from doing the truth. But at the end of the day, you know what I mean? All things work for the good of the Most High. And I believe that's in Romans. But I can't find it. Let me try and see if I find it. All things work to the good. Yeah, I don't know where it says to rock it. I'm going, letting this keep on running. So, back to the lesson. Himself, for a woman, himself, a Philistine woman, the man that his parents get her for me to wife. Judges 14:2. It's shame for a man's right, but not unusual for Israelites. Intermarriage has always been a stumbling block for the Jews. Esau had two Gentile wives, but Esau is an Israelite. So, see, that's just, see how they go off. Esau had two Gentile wives. Joseph married an Egyptian. Moses, the greatest of the Israelites, married a Midianite. I thought he married an African. But David wed Bathsheba, who was probably not a native Israelite. Solomon was the worst offender, contracting marriages with Gentiles and sharing their false powers. This was the divine line. Idolatry and a racial marriage was blessed by Yahweh if it resulted in worshiping him alone. Ezra the scribe, who led a host of Jews back to the Holy Land from Babylon, from the Babylonian captivity, led a thoroughgoing revival of marriage practices. The worthy priest went in his garment and plucked out his hair, desperate and despairing at the intermarriage of his people. He instituted a season of repentance marked by the putting away of foreign wives and their children. Ezra, chapter 10, verse 3. There was an angry outcry against Ezra's reforms. Many Jews fled Judea for Samaria, separating themselves from Israel forever. Ironically, Jews in Europe after 70 AD found their laws against intermarriage were matched by law of the church prohibiting marriage. To Jews, this mutual prohibition reduced intermarriage to its lowest point. One, through the Middle Ages, when a modest kind of toleration took place in Europe, intermarriage rose dramatically for Jews from Central Europe to Scandinavia. Yeah, but this is talking about them fake-ass Jews. Jews flocked to New York early in the 20th century when they occurred. The war against intermarriage was virtually at the end. The rebirth of the State of Israel. I'm gonna say, and so we're going to start reading that bullshit because, like I said, everybody knows. The whole internet knows. And even people don't want to admit those ain't the real fucking Jews. Every few years we hear a new story about a person who made a great promise. Slovakia, who made great promises to people but then stole their money, for which they likely worked very hard. Often we see these people brought to justice, but their victims have had to learn a painful lesson. When Yahweh makes a promise, it is not a ploy to deceive or swindle. Yahweh always has our best interests at heart, and he needs nothing from any of us. Whenever Yahweh by Hashem Yahweh Shai sent an angel to forewarn people that something important was about to happen, it always turned out just the way he promised it would. In this week's lesson, we learned that Yahweh sent the angel of the Lord to Manoah's barren wife. He gave her very good news. He told her that she would become pregnant with a son. Yahweh gave specific instructions about how she was to care for the child even before he was born. Yahweh had his hand on the baby from the beginning. Because of Israel's disobedience, the people had been oppressed by the Philistines for 40 years. Here we see a real kind of thing, much like the stories of Mary and Sarah. The promise of the baby would bring deliverance to Israel. The personal outline. Yahweh's promise. Judges 13:1-3. After 40 years of being at the mercy of the Philistines, Yahweh decided to begin Israel's deliverance. Noah's wife, whose name was not mentioned, had been previously unable to bear children, but the angel of the Lord told her that she would bear a son. God's instructions. Judges 13:4-5. Yahweh sent Samson's mother instructions not to drink anything containing alcohol or to eat anything deemed unclean while she was pregnant. While these instructions are easy to understand, no one knows exactly why Yahweh decided that Samson's strength should depend on his hair, which was never to be cut. In the womb, Yahweh chose Samson to be a deliverer for Israel. 3. Yahweh's countenance. Judges 13:6-7. Although she did not know his name, Manoah's wife recognized the countenance of Yahweh when the visiting angel. That could be true because, you know what I'm saying, like, the angels are holy because the Most High is holy, so. Then they talk about his countenance was terrible, so you know. Verse 4, Yahweh's promise kept. Judges 13:24-25. Manoah's wife bore a son, just as Yahweh said she would. Not only did Yahweh bless the child, but when the right time came, the Holy Spirit moved in order to fulfill Yahweh by Hashem Yahweh Shah's plan. That's a Lachia plan. And with that, I'm going to end the lesson. I want to give all praise, honor, and glory to Yahweh, Baal Hashem, Yahweh Shah, Baal Hashem, Yerkah, Kadash, Barakatah. Double honors to the apostles and elders, a great millstone. Peace and salutations to the Akim around the four corners of the earth, pushing the truth through faith and sincerity. Like I said, this lesson was edifying. We'll come out with a lesson next week. So Moses, and you know, with that, Shalom, and you know, may death come on swift wings to this wicked ass place. Abba, Abba, Shalom.